Hello, I'm Dr. David Waterhouse, Senior Curator of Natural History and Geology at Norfolk Museums Service, and welcome to an introduction to the rocks and fossils of Norfolk. Of course, I'm going to be using the internationally important geology collections of Norfolk Museums Service to guide you through this topic. They include many thousands of specimens. They mostly reflect the geology of the county and therefore are largely fossils from the chalk, crag, and ice age deposits, which we'll find out more about as we go. But it's not just the material curated at the castle that makes up the geology collections at Norfolk Museums Service. A small but significant collection concentrating particularly on the rocks and fossils of West Norfolk and the Fens is cared for at the Lynn Museum. And at Cromer Museum, the wonderful geology gallery features rocks and fossils of the coast. Now, the rocks beneath us tell the story of the world millions of years deep into the past. Each section of rock contains clues to how the world looked at any given time long ago. It's the story of an ever-changing landscape, warm seas to frozen tundra, deserts to temperate river estuaries. As you know, Norfolk is largely an agricultural county. It doesn't have deposits of coal, tin, or iron ore buried underground. However, it is famous for its geology because along its coastline, where the sea erodes fossil-rich cliffs, the remains of many extraordinary creatures have been found. This important stretch of coastline is known as Norfolk's Deep History Coast. If we look at this simplified diagram of the rocks and sediments around Cromer, which I produced for Cromer Museum some years ago, we can see just how complex the geology is. By the way, I've exaggerated the landscape by 10 times here. Cromer would be a very different place if the cliffs were this steep in real life. Let's start at the deepest point exposed here. The whitish layer represents the chalk deposits of Norfolk. This pure limestone was formed during the Cretaceous period, about 100 million to 70 million years ago. They're known as the white chalk deposits, and within them are preserved the remains of a fascinating variety of ancient animals. During the Cretaceous period, which literally means chalky period, East Anglia and much of Europe were covered in a warm, wide sea. The climate was subtropical and reptiles ruled the world. Dinosaurs dominated the land, whilst pterosaurs inhabited the skies. Giant marine reptiles such as ichthyosaurs, pliosaurs, mosasaurs and plesiosaurs, only distantly related to the dinosaurs, occupied the top of the food chain in the sea. They preyed upon sharks and other fish, turtles and crocodiles. These, in turn, fed upon animals such as smaller fish, ammonites and belemnites, the extinct swimming mollusks related to today's cuttlefish. On the seabed lived large numbers of sponges, corals, lobsters, crabs, mollusks, brachiopods, sea urchins and crinoids. The last two are related to modern starfish. It was the countless millions of tiny plankton skeletons called coccoliths that accumulated on the sea floor which created the deep chalk deposits upon which Norfolk rests today, and which can be seen exposed in the cliffs on the coast. Synonymous with chalk is flint, as this silica-rich stone formed within the chalk. If it weren't for the billions of sea sponges living on the seafloor during the Cretaceous period, then we wouldn't have had flint at all. That's because the main mineral in flint is silica, and this derived from the skeletons of the sponges themselves. Silica, which is also the main component of glass, normally doesn't dissolve in water. But millions of years ago, some strange chemistry led to it dispersing into the water and reforming in a sort of gel-like substance, until finally it hardened into the flint we know today. This is why flint is found in organic, sometimes odd-looking shapes. It also tended to form in and around decaying matter, which is why you get fossils like sea urchins and even worm burrows preserved in flint today. There's a gap of over 60 million years between the most recent chalk deposits and the establishment of the next geological formation found in Norfolk. This is because any sediment that were laid down during this time were washed away by the later seas that formed the evocative-sounding crag group. The word crag actually comes from East Anglia and means a layer of fossil seashells or shelly, sandy or gravelly rocks. Now, the crag formations cover much of East Anglia, and their exact nature varies from place to place. Within them can be found the well-fossilised remains of sea-dwelling animals, such as mollusks, fish, and occasionally dolphin, walrus and whale. And also land-dwelling animals, such as horse, rhino, deer, and early species of mammoth. The fossils of land animals can be found amongst the sea creatures because their remains were occasionally carried out to sea by rivers. The crag group is made up of layers of clays, muds, sands, gravels and pebbles. They're often cemented together by iron-rich sediments, which give the deposits a reddish or orange colour. They're generally between about 2 million and 5 million years old, and represent cool and temperate marine conditions, becoming gradually cooler as the ice ages approached. The Cromer Forest Bed Formation. Exposed on the deep eastern coast of North Norfolk are river and woodland deposits that are about 500,000 to well over a million years old. It's the richest source of fossils anywhere in the British Isles from the Pleistocene epoch, between around 12,000 and 2.6 million years ago. Exposures of this formation can be found in cliffs from Weyburn in the north to just over the border in Kesingland in Suffolk in the south. These important deposits have been studied for over 250 years and are vital to our understanding of how climate change affects animal populations. The forest bed at West Runton is the type locality for the Cromerian stage and is the benchmark against which all other sites of this age in Europe are measured. The West Runton mammoth was found in the forest bed. The remains of this huge animal were found in what is sometimes known as the West Runton freshwater bed. This is a 1.5 metre thick layer of organic rich mud within the Cromer Forest Bed Formation, which was deposited by a medium-sized river about 600,000 to 700,000 years ago, before the most extreme cold period of the recent ice age, the Anglian glaciation. There have been many species of elephant living in the British Isles over the last few million years. The West Runton mammoth belongs to a species called Mammuthus trogontherii, also known as the steppe mammoth, but perhaps more accurately described as a giant forest mammoth. Standing at least 4 metres at its shoulder, the West Runton mammoth would have weighed about 10 tonnes, twice the weight of any African elephant. It's the largest elephant skeleton ever found in Britain, and was probably one of the biggest animals ever to have lived on land, except for the very largest dinosaurs. It's also the oldest elephant skeleton to have been found in the UK, although some older individual teeth and bones exist. Only a few other skeletons of this species are known, from Germany, Serbia and Russia. The West Runton mammoth skeleton is about 85% complete. When the first bones of the mammoth were discovered after storms in the winters of the early 1990s, Norfolk Museums Service applied for funding to excavate what was obviously a very important find. To recover the rest of such a complete skeleton during the 1995 excavation, so well preserved and with so many bones, was a very welcome surprise. So, is he an elephant or a mammoth? Some people refer to it as the West Runton elephant, and others as the West Runton mammoth. So which one is correct? The answer is, they're technically both right. The mammoth is just a type of elephant. When the fossilised remains were first found, it was briefly thought that they might belong to another extinct species called a straight-tusked elephant. When it was discovered that it was a steppe mammoth, some people still called it an elephant, so as not to confuse it with the smaller, hairier, woolly mammoth. These days, we all tend to call it the West Runton mammoth, which is a much more specific and accurate term. Over the last 2.5 million years, the British Isles and the rest of Europe have experienced repeated cycles of warm and very cold climates. This has had a profound effect on the animals and plants living here. During severely cold periods, which could last for tens of thousands of years, ice caps formed over the highlands of Europe and expanded, covering much of the land in sheets of ice, in places up to 4 kilometres thick. That's nearly 2.5 miles. When this happened, many animals retreated to southern Europe, where it was slightly warmer. Some species didn't survive the harsh conditions of the ice ages and became extinct. Other animals, such as reindeer, bison, woolly mammoths, and woolly rhinos, thrived as they were adapted to living in cool climates. When conditions improved during the occasional warmer but shorter interglacial periods, the ice sheets melted and retreated, leaving behind the debris they had brought with them on their journey. The cold-adapted animals would retreat northwards as well. The British Isles were connected to Europe as a peninsula for much of this period, so each time the conditions improved, some animals were able to make their way back from their refuges in southern Europe. During the warmest phases, hyenas, elephants, monkeys, pond terrapins, and even hippos lived in Norfolk. Fossils of both these warm-adapted and cold-adapted animals are regularly found in Norfolk. In fact, the fossils and sediments preserved in Norfolk during the Ice Ages are the most significant in the British Isles for this time period, and are amongst the very best in Europe. Every year, students come from far and wide to study them in order to learn about the interaction between climate and landscape. So what about people in this landscape during our deep history? Well, as far as we know, 4 different species of human have lived in the British Isles, and Norfolk is the only county to have evidence of all 4 of these. Stone tools and even human footprints from Haysborough in Norfolk demonstrate that humans first appeared in Britain much earlier than previously thought. The evidence shows that these early pioneers were in North Norfolk a remarkable 850,000 years ago or more. No human bones have been found at Haysborough, just stone tools and some extraordinary sets of footprints. But the age of this site puts it in the range of the only European fossil human material yet known from that period, which was discovered in Spain. These fossils were of an early human known as Homo antecessor, pioneer man, and so it is thought that Homo antecessor was present at Haysborough over 850,000 years ago. By around 700,000 years ago, a new species of human appeared in Africa, Asia and Europe. Homo heidelbergensis, Heidelberg man, had a larger brain than Homo antecessor, and with this large brain may have come greater intelligence and more developed speech capabilities. The Haysborough hand axe, discovered in 2000, is a typical Homo heidelbergensis flint butchery tool, dating from around 500,000 years ago. From Homo heidelbergensis rose 2 other species, Homo neanderthalensis, Neanderthals, and Homo sapiens, modern humans, us. Neanderthals lived in Europe, including Norfolk, during the Ice Ages, from around 250,000 years ago to 25,000 years ago, overlapping with modern humans towards the end. In 2002, an amazing Neanderthal site was found at Linford in Thetford Forest, Norfolk. Here, 60,000 years ago, Neanderthals probably used their flint hand axes to butcher and eat the remains of several cold-adapted animals: woolly mammoths, woolly rhino, and reindeer. The Neanderthals were very successful species who dominated Europe for 225,000 years throughout some of the most extreme climatic conditions imaginable. We do not know for sure why they eventually died out just 25,000 years ago. We, modern humans, probably evolved in Africa about 300,000 years ago. We spread to Asia about 60,000 years ago and reached Europe by about 40,000 years ago, where we overlapped with the Neanderthals for about 5,000 years or so. Since then, the only times we have been absent from Norfolk was during the very cold periods of the Ice Ages. All of these human species made stone tools, mostly from flint. They had their own particular manufacturing styles and tool kits, so we can often tell by the shape of the tools to which species they belonged. So there you go, 100 million years of history right beneath our feet. From the mysterious and exotic chalky seas of the Cretaceous period to our early relatives living here nearly a million years ago, Norfolk has it all. Many of these important discoveries, such as the West Runton Mammoth and Haysborough Hand Axe, have been made by members of the public. Next time you go down to the beach or wander through our landscape, who knows what you will find.